I still want to say, for you who got baptized today, go home and read Romans chapter 6. When I got baptized, there was no manifestation, nothing happened right there, visible, because I did not understand it. But when I went home and read it, it just clicked. Everything just changed. So no matter how big manifestation, how small manifestation, what happened today, it's still a new life. It's still a new beginning. And God know that, Satan know that, and you're going to feel it. Okay? Okay, but can we play one more song? Where is my the guitar man? Christy? Jesse, what is his name? Christian, I'm so bad at names. Come on, Christian. A little information. Tomorrow, we have a meeting at Glad Tiding Church. It's not this church, it's another church. There's not room for everyone, but just come anyway. And we see what happened. 10:30. And I'm going to speak there. It's going to be like a little more normal church. I don't know. The pastor is Paul, who just baptized, and I don't think anything will be normal in that church from now on. Because he loves it. But we're going to have a meeting there at 10:30 tomorrow where I'm going to speak. I think I'm going to talk about being led by the Holy Spirit and hearing the voice of God. Then we're going to meet back here later. If you cannot come there, just meet back here later. Where tomorrow we're going to somehow end it up with testimony, and I'm going to put all our things together. All we have learned the last days, put it together, explain how it can look like, and prepare you as good as possible for the future when you go home. Because what we want this to not be just an event, those 3 days we are here. We want it to be alive. And it can be alive. It's really up to you if you want it. It's so simple.
Yes, if you want.
Okay, I have a message now that I say this is often the most radical message we are going to preach when we are out. This is really going to challenge many of you. When I'm finished with this message, you are welcome to come up and get prayed for, or people can pray for each other. But it's not a message to invite people to come and get prayed for. It's more a message to invite people to go home and think about your life. So if we can, when I'm finished with this message, if you want prayer, there will be people up here who can receive you and who can pray for you. Otherwise, we also have time to pray for each other tomorrow. But this is a good message to really think about life. I need 4 people to help me, who can stand up here the next hour. So 4 people who can stand up here the next hour. 1, 2, 3, 1 more, 4. Just come up here. What you're going to do is you stand here, 1 there, 1 there, 1 there, and 1 there. Chris, can you come up? He's going to help me also. Just stand there. You just stand there. Yeah. Hold this in front of you. This is my friend Chris. Chris from America. Chris and his wife Christy have a few kids. They are helping us now here, and he's going to say something later into this also, so we are going to help each other. I would just pray. God, thank you for everything you're doing. Thank you for the amazing testimonies we heard today. Thank you for what you have been doing today and yesterday and what you're going to do tomorrow. Come with your Holy Spirit and open our eyes and our ears and help us, Jesus, to walk with you. Help us to live as true disciples and help us to bear fruit. Come and set us free, and I pray that this message will open our eyes and our ears and speak to us. In the name of Jesus. Amen. In Mark chapter 4, you see Jesus telling the parable of the 4 grounds, where he's talking about there is 4 grounds, or let's say 4 different kind of people who all receive the word. But the response of what happened when they receive the word is different. One of the ground number one is the one who received the word, and as soon as they have heard the word, Satan come and steal it, so it do not bear fruit. This is how the kingdom of God is growing. When Jesus is talking about this parable, this is how it is. And this is your, this are going to be your and my experience when we are telling about Jesus. I often meet people who are ground number one. People who receive the word and listen to the word, but as soon as they listen, Satan steal it. When that happens, we don't give up, we don't cry, we just take the dust off our hands and feet and go to the next person. We also meet people who are ground number two. This is people who receive the word. And those people can actually be those people who repent and get baptized, and everything seems good for a time, but then persecution set in because of the word. And because of persecution, they fall away. And I've seen that a lot in life. I met many people who received the word. It seems like everything is good, and suddenly we don't see them anymore. They experience persecution from family, from friends, from other people. And because of persecution, they fall away. This is what we will experience. This is how the kingdom of God is. Jesus also said we meet people who are ground number three. This is people who receive the word. But after a short time, other things come in and quench the word so it do not bear fruit. But we also meet ground number four. Those people who are not ground one, ground two, ground three, but ground number four. Those people who bear fruit. And those people bear a lot of fruit. When Jesus is telling this parable, his disciples did not understand it in the beginning. But Jesus said to them, if you don't understand this parable, how can you then understand the rest? Because this is a parable about how the kingdom of God is working and how everything looks, why things look like they do. But this is not only a parable about what we experience when we share the gospel. Because the truth is that everybody in this room is one of those four grounds. There's nothing between. There's only four grounds. And out of those four grounds, there is only one ground who bear fruit. Ground number four. And ground number four do not just bear a little fruit, but a lot of fruit. 3,000, 6,000, 9,000% fruit. A lot of fruit. Do Jesus want us to bear fruit? How much? So much he said that every branch on me who do not bear fruit, I cut it off, throw it away. And every branch who bear fruit, I prune it so it bear even more fruit. He wants us to bear fruit. Of course, there's different kind of fruit. There's Galatians 5, 20, 22, fruit of the Spirit. Joy, peace, so on. But there's also the fruit like the Father has sent me, I now send you, go out and bear much fruit. The question is, what ground are you? From the beginning on, if I look at this, there is four grounds, there's only one who bear fruit. So right now there's 25% chance that you are the good ground who are going to bear a lot of fruit. Let's look at this. Can you stand up? Ground number one. Is that you? Ground number one is the people who receive the word, but as soon as we have heard the word, Satan come and steal it so it do not bear fruit. Is that you? I don't think so. You are here Saturday evening. Everybody who sit in a church Saturday evening have received the word, otherwise you would do other things. So let's say, okay, this is not us, so you can stand there. Now there's 33% chance that you are the good ground who are going to bear a lot of fruit. Let's look at it. Ground number two. Ground number two is the one who received the word. But as soon as they received the word, persecution set in. Is that you? That one is a little difficult. Because we are living in a country where we normally don't see persecution. And that is a bad thing. Because persecution is not bad. Persecution is necessary. When Jesus is talking about that ground, what is happening is that the seed is sown and it starts to bear fruit. The only thing we see with the visible eyes is what is happening over the ground. But then the sun is coming and standing on the sky, and the sun is showing what is happening under the ground, how deep the roots have gone. And because the root is not deep, it wither and die. Because the root is not deep, it fall away. Persecution shows how deep the roots is in our life. We have been cheated. Because many of the big churches we look to now and want to be like, whoa, there are many, they're big. That day persecution set in, they're not there. The American gospel is a bad gospel. We are used to that gospel. Hey, give your life to Jesus, it will be your best life now. Yeah, I'm quoting a book right now. Try to imagine to take our American gospel, as I call it, and go back to the time of Jesus. Or go to the persecution country. Hey, come and give your life to Jesus. What do you want to do with your life? Be a football player. If you give your life to Jesus, you're going to be the best football player in the world. What do you want to do with your life? God, he will give you exactly what you need. If we preach that gospel, then we look at us and say, what? What do you mean about my best life now? Give my life to Jesus and he will take care of all my needs. My uncle gave his life to Jesus. They burned down his house. My other sister gave her life to Jesus. She's in jail. My father gave his life to Jesus and they killed him. What do you mean about give your life to Jesus? He's going to fix my life. Try to imagine Jesus. At Jesus' time, he had 12 disciples, 12 apostles. Out of those 12 apostles, this is like 12 there. Out of those 12 apostles, there was only one who did not die as a martyr. Or Judas died like this, but there was only John who lived a long life. So out of those 12 apostles, we had a martyr percent of over 90. So 90% of people in Jesus' church died. That means that if you look at this, that means like almost like 90%, like, okay, guys, you're going to live a long life, the rest, you're going to die. If we then think of that, try to imagine to come into a place where it was about, you know that this is going to cost you your life. Suddenly the gospel gives a new meaning. When Jesus is saying, if anybody wants to follow me, he has to deny himself and take up the cross and follow me. Today when we read the same words, oh, deny myself and take up the cross. Yeah, I'm carrying Jesus' cross. Mine is in gold. Do you want to see my gold cross? No, to take up the cross and follow Jesus, they knew what he meant. Why? Because people was hanging on the cross around the road. And when Jesus was saying the one who keep on to his life is going to lose it, but the one who lay down his life for my sake is going to win it. We have been cheated, we have been deceived. And I'm so afraid for our American way of doing Christianity, because everybody thinks, oh, everything is good, everything is nice. But the truth is that most people in our Western churches are ground number two, but they don't see it. They don't see it. Because we have learned something really, we know something, maybe don't think of it, but The truth when it comes to persecution is that it's so easy to get persecution to disappear. If you don't like persecution, I don't like, but I'm a person, I don't like people who don't like me. Like, I'm a very person, I hate conflicts. Me as a personality, I like people and I like when people like me. I hate conflicts. And when I say to people, I hate conflicts and I just want everybody to like me, people sometimes look at me and say, then you need to find a new job. Yeah, I hate conflicts, but I love Jesus more. But what I've seen that it is so easy to make persecution disappear. Just do one thing. Just remember one word. Just that one thing. If you do that one thing, I guarantee you, you're going to get an easy life now. The word is compromise. Just do that one thing. Just compromise. When you're going to go home from this conference, home to your own city, and going to start baptizing people, and the pastor invite you into the office, just compromise. Just say, sorry, I'm never going to do it again. And I guarantee you, persecution will stop. And this is the sad thing, that many of you have seen something the last 2 days, you have tasted something the last 2 days, and you want it. But as soon as you go home from here and start to live this life, persecution is going to start. And what we sometimes forget is it was not the sinners who crucified Jesus. He didn't have a problem with sinners, he had a problem with the religious people. And he's going to be the same one more time, nothing new under the sun. I want you to think of this because if you take what you have learned the last days and really start to live it out, welcome to the real world. A world of persecution, a world where you're going to lose friends, where you're going to lose a lot of things. And sometimes I get a little provoked when people look at me and think, whoa, Torben, you just got it like this. It have cost a price. We have lost so many friends, I cannot count them on five hands. We have been time after time, needed to change, to choose, what do I want to do, obey man or obey God? And maybe you like me, but there's many who don't. So what ground are you? Are you ground number two? I don't know. Time will show. Let's look at the next one. Let's say you're not ground number two. Now there's 50% chance that you are the good ground who are going to bear a lot of fruit. So now there is only one thing and one thing alone you need to be careful of. If you don't fall in this ground, you are ground number four. But if I'm going to say to you, there's one thing you need to be careful of. Please be careful of this. If I say in the church today, be careful. One thing. Most Christians would think of, okay, that would be big sin, like sexual sin, homosexuality, or drugs and other things, but it's not what Jesus is talking about. He's not talking about big sins. What he is warning us about is something like this: the deceitfulness of riches, worries, and longing for other things. I start with this: the deceitfulness of riches. The truth is, you are deceived. The thing that is killing most people in this room, thing number one is your house. Number two is your job. And you don't see it because this is the deceitfulness of riches. It come in and deceived us. What do I mean? I mean this. I met so many young people who are on fire, love Jesus. We love Jesus. We want to serve God. Yeah, we want to serve God the rest of their life. Young people on fire, Then the parents come to them. I love you, fire. I love you, fire, young man. But you have to have an education to fall back on. But I want you. Do you have to have an education, young man? So let's take the education. 5 years later, they're standing with the paper in their hand and they have the education and the fire of God is gone. Fire is gone. I've seen that so many, many times. Or people who get married and they're on fire. We want to serve God. We want to serve God. They dream about being missionary. They dream about living 100% for Jesus and don't want to live a normal, carnal life, going to church every Sunday and going home again. They want to serve God. They're on fire. They love Jesus. We want to serve God. Yes. And one day, wow, look at that house. Oh, I want that house. Oh, it's so beautiful. And then they get the house, and it's an old house, but it's nice. But they fix the kitchen, it's old. Then they make a new kitchen. Then the kitchen is new, and everything looks old compared to the kitchen. So they fix the living room and the bathroom and so on, and suddenly they spend 1.5 years fixing the house. And then it's time for the garden, and they fix the garden, and they fix the house, and they fix the garden, and they fix the house. And already there, they look at the house, see, look at our beautiful house. They're deceived because it's not their house, it's the bank who owned the house. But now they have to pay the bank what they own the bank, so they have to work a lot. They work, come home, work, come home, work, come home. And when they come home for work, and they don't have more to give. Why? Because they're giving the best time of the day working for mammon from the house. And the whole week is gone, and then you come to weekend. Oh, it's time for me and my family and ourselves. And then you do this, and then 2 hours in church on Sunday, and then a new week. And then a new week. And then a new week. And suddenly you have spent 5, 10, 15 years. And what about your dream? What about the things you want to live for God and you want to live as a missionary and you want to bear fruit? It's just never going to happen. Why? Because you're deceived. Can you follow me? And I know what I'm talking about because I fell in that ground some years ago. Me and my wife, we became older, like everybody else. And we have lived a simple life for years and served God and loved Jesus. But one day I got my dream house. Yeah, I got my house. And remember when I got my house, I was so happy and I was looking at my house and my house. I fixed the kitchen, I fixed the back room, fixed the floor, I painted everything. And I spent so much time on my house. And my house was a beautiful house. It's like every line in the house should be. When I fixed the house, it was so beautiful. Like I looked at my house and I was fixing my house and I was working a lot because it cost a lot of money. And when I came home from work, I didn't have more to give. And my wife looked at me, come on, Tom, you're just sitting there seeing TV, but I'm tired. And time just, suddenly 1.5, 2 years, it just went like this. No fruit, no change, didn't have time to see God, didn't have time to listen. I was deceived from everyday life. The deceitfulness of riches. Worries about everything, longing for other things. The neighbor got a new car, I need a new car. And you know what? You don't bear fruit there. You don't bear fruit. Why? Because you don't have time to bear fruit. But one day I got fired.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't say that when I got fired. When I got fired, I cried. When I got the house, I said, yay, but it should be opposite. Because what happened when I got fired? Yeah, I don't say it like this. Because when I got fired, suddenly I could not pay the bill. I could not get a job. So I, God, where are you? Where are you? And I start to cry out and I start to see God. And the scary thing was, when I really needed God, I found out he was long time since I've heard him last. It was actually long time, slowly he have come further and further and further away from me. And when I suddenly need him, like, where are you? When have I last time been fasting? When have I last time been praying? When have I last time really sought him? I haven't. I've been deceived from everyday life. And I started to see God and pray, and I really needed God, and I fasted 40 days, and I like, God, if you're not coming, I'm dying. And there he came, and he started to speak to me. He started to lead me. And the more I sought him, the more he spoke to me, the more I experienced how the Holy Spirit was leading. And every time I experienced this, just created more life in me. More life. More life. And the more life I got, you, when I came back to ground number three, me and my wife, we looked at our life and say, we don't want this life anymore. We are tasting something that's better. We want this 100%. But we knew that if we want to have this life, we need to make some changes. We need more time. Yeah, we say everybody had 24 hours per day, we have. But what do we do with that time we have? So we needed to make radical change in Sony. The first thing I did was throw the Hill machine out of the house. You know, Hill machine? Some people call it TV, it's different names. When I got rid of the Hill machine or the TV, then I sat down. There was nothing to look at. And it was weird in the beginning because I was used to just sitting down and watching TV, sitting down and watching TV. And suddenly I didn't have it anymore. So I could pray instead. I could read the Bible. And God started to change us. And my wife, every time we change something to have more time to see God and do his will, the more we experience. And the more we experience, the more we hungered for this life. The more we wanted. And one day we started to just, we knew we need to live a simple life. We need to get rid of all the things. We had so many things in our life and it just distracted us. It's not easy to hear God's words and God's voice if you have so many things going around all the time. For example, our kids' room, we had two girls and a boy. And our kids' room that time, it was pink, our girl room. There were so many toys. If I came into my girl room, it was like, my girl's room is like pink all over the place. Like, and if I was going to clean it, it was like, okay. And it was, I get so stressful. My heart came up and I was standing on the girl's room and like, Lena, help me, because I was drowning in pink toys. So one day we said, well, we want to live a different life. So we took a big black bag and we took the kids in and we took the toys up and we said, what do you want to keep, this or this? Both, no, this or this. This, out with this. What do you want to keep, this or this? This, out with this. What do you want to keep? And we just emptied the room. When we emptied the room, the first thing I discovered was there was a floor. Actually, nice floor. I put it myself. But then I came into the room and suddenly I could breathe again. It was like... Now there was one less thing in my life to stress about. I could breathe. And from that day on, our girls could clean their own room. And since that, we have never cleaned their room. And there we got even more time to see God, even more time to do God's will. And what happened? We start to experience greater things, greater things, greater things. I want to tell one of many testimonies. Suddenly we have the whole world just to see God. We got rid of more, we got rid of more, we start to live a simple life. And I experienced amazing things. One day I was out praying and seeking God, and I saw a famous stand-up comedian from Denmark, and I saw him and just recognized that person. And I felt I should go to him. Oh, that guy, Simon Juhl, the stand-up comedian. So I chose to go to him, and I went to him to talk to that guy, Simon Juhl. Yeah, just keep it, that's fine. And I went to talk to that stand-up comedian, and as soon as I came to him, he turned his face, and I saw it's not Simon Juhl. It's not just one who looked like that stand-up comedian. And then God spoke to me, and he said, pray for Simon Juhl. And I think, pray for the one who looked like, or the real one. Pray for the real one. And God spoke to me at the same time that I should pray for Open Door to TV so I could go against evolution and Darwin. And it was so weird to experience that. Why should I pray for Simon Juhl? And why should I pray for Open Door to TV? It didn't make sense. But suddenly I was walking and praying and said, God, help me. Well, God, do something. God, I pray for this guy, Simon Juhl. I pray for Open Door to TV so I can go against evolution and Darwin. And I was praying that. When I came home for prayer that day, the telephone called, and I took it. I said, hi, this is from Danish TV. We are making a program about evolution and Darwin. We want to hear if you want to be part of it. The one who's going to interview you is the stand-up comedian, Simon Juhl. So God spoke, he led me, and 2 weeks after, I was together with Simon Juhl, and I was part of a program, and God did amazing things. And I tasted that. I said, I want more. And I started to experience dreams. I started to experience vision. I started to experience how the Holy Spirit was leading me. And one day, we got rid of everything, and we were living a simple life, living in a basement with 3 kids. And everybody looked at us like we are crazy. Our friends and family, like, do you really live in a small basement with 3 kids? Our Christian friends look at us like we are crazy. But we have something our Christian friends did not have. A lot of time to see God. Because before, when I have the house and have the car and have everything, I have to pay $3,500. $3,000 actually. No, we are in Canada. $3,500 per month for everything. So every month I needed to work a lot to pay $3,500. But when we live in the basement, I just needed $500 to live. So when all the rest was working, I had time to do God's will, to seek Him, and to be led by the Holy Spirit. And it was down there in that basement one day God spoke to me and said, Torben, do a pioneer school. What? And God has just changed everything since that. I've learned something important. Seek first the will of God and do His will. And then the rest will be added to you. But we have to start with seeking God, and we have to start doing His will. And let Him come and bless us. But it's not only me who have experienced a transition from being ground number 2 at one time, because I was a guy who compromised a lot. Some areas. Baptism was something I did not talk about at all, like I do now. Come on, I'm from Denmark, it's a Lutheran country. 90% is baptized as babies. So nobody dare to talk about baptism, because most free churches, Baptist churches, Pentecostal churches have people from the state church, and nobody talk about baptism. So I was a guy who was compromising, but I changed that. I was a guy who was being deceived by this world, but I changed that. And now I bear a lot of fruit. This is my friend Chris, and Chris, he had been on a journey the last years where he also needed to go from that ground to become ground number 4. And I'll let him say something.
Praise God. So you guys have seen some stuff the last couple days, yeah? Yeah. Do you want it to continue? Do you want to be ground four? Amen. Jesus said to count the cost to follow him. Okay, the way of Jesus is not a lukewarm way. We can't walk the fence. We can't, on the weekends, go to church and cast out demons, and then during the week, go live for ourselves. We just can't do it. Jesus warned us about this in Revelations. He says, if you're lukewarm, he said he would vomit you out of his mouth. That's a really descriptive word. Guys, we know that when we come into God, that we're grafted into God's family, right? We're into God's family. But Jesus says, if you don't bear fruit, that he will cut you off and throw you into the fire. This is a scary thing. He's not talking to the world. We already know where they're going. Guys, he's talking to those who proclaim to know him. Okay? This is a scary thought. Guys, this is life and death. We must bear fruit as believers. We must. I know we go back to ground one. We think, a lot of times, we think when we're out on the street, and some of us here, of course, we're not ground one, right? But a lot of people that I've met that I've received a lot of persecution from are ground one. They don't even have the foundation of the gospel. And you're going to encounter that. I'm very aware that we're going to go home. You're going to go back to your jobs. You're going to go back to your houses. Okay? You're going to go back to your friends, the real world. And life's going to start on Monday morning. Okay? And it's like we have this great weekend where you're amongst believers, and we've been casting out demons and baptizing people and healing the sick, and it's just amazing. It's absolutely amazing. And then Monday morning is going to happen. And this is when ground two starts. Guys, I want you to think about something. Think about Jesus, okay? He had the 12 disciples, right? Jesus could have done without every one of those disciples except for one. Judas. Jesus needed Judas to betray him, to persecute him, to send him to the cross. Okay, in my life, this is the very thing that has driven me closer to God, is ground number two, and persevering through persecution, because you're going to go home. This gospel that we preach is not a lukewarm gospel. It is radical. And it is the way of Jesus. It's the way of the cross. Jesus is radical. He's radical, and he's looking for people who want to be radical to follow him. And you're going to stand out. Right? Let our light shine among men in the darkness. The only way to let our light shine is to turn it on in the darkness. I think of it a lot of times. Sometimes I'll just be standing in a mall, and you see the harvest is great, right? To go get them. I think of it like this. Come into that mall. Come into these people. Go to the skate park and be the explosion that Jesus is, to let your light shine. And don't be afraid of persecution, because Jesus said it is coming. The wolves are out there. Expect it. It's coming. But it's our choice how we're going to respond. Are we going to be stuck in ground two? And we go home on Monday morning and say, it hurts. Guys, I know it hurts. And persecution in my life, and in Torben's life. Guys, a lot of times it's come from the church. It's come from the religious people. It's come from family. And it hurts. And nobody likes that. I don't like that. I don't like that. You don't like that. But to follow Jesus is to forsake all and to continue after him. That's what it means. That's what it means to follow Jesus, to forsake all. Take up your cross and follow him, to continue to pursue him. I'll touch on ground three. You know, I went to a kickstart 6 months ago, had received the gospel, been baptized, and I went home on that next Monday morning. I went back to work. I worked a graveyard shift, so I worked through the night. Of course, I wanted to be a good father, a good husband, and yet I had this fire on the inside of me now. Okay, Jesus, you want me to do this radical thing for you? You want me to live this life? And I went back to work, and slowly, 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 I saw that fire begin to go. And I was just crying out to God one day. I said, God, what's going on? Where are you? I feel the weight of the world on my shoulders. God, what's going on? I have this inside of me, but how do I share this? How do I get this out? I'm exhausted. I'm going to work. I come home. I try to spend time with my family. Jesus told me very clearly. God spoke to me in that moment of brokenness. He said, son, I did not create you to do this. This is not my burden. This is not my yoke. And I heard him so clearly. He said, to seek me first, the kingdom of God, and I will add unto you. And I said, okay, God, your word is true. You don't lie. I'm going to take you at your word, and I'm going to test you at your word. And during this time, my wife was set free from some things, and we said, okay, God, I want to see this thing that I saw on the weekend. I want to see people get healed. I want to see demons cast out. God, I want to bear fruit for your kingdom. This is the life that I want, because there is no other life. Guys, we can't walk the line. God's not looking for that. He's looking for people who are on fire for him. And so for me in my life, I was a slave to Wells Fargo. Okay, I owned two houses. I had the cars. I had a high-paying job. And it was something that I had to maintain that job because of all the debt that I had. Of course, we have four kids, me and my wife, and praise God, we've been married 11 years as of 2 days ago. And of course, you guys heard a little bit of my testimony yesterday, and it's just by the grace of God. But me and my wife desperately wanted to be in Ground Floor, but we were here because of the deceitfulness of riches. You know, we often look around and we look at our neighbors and we say, oh, God's blessed us, and look at all the stuff we have. But yet we look over at our neighbor, and they have the same things we have. So is God blessing them too, or are we just working just as hard as they are? In my life, I was working just as hard as my neighbor was. We had the same things, okay? So I took God at his word, and I tested him. And I'm not going to, you know, I'll say this. God has a purpose for every one of our lives. So your story may not have to look like mine. But in our life, the thing that kept me from Ground Floor was my job, was my house, was the deceitfulness of riches. And so God just said, get rid of it all. And I said, God, I'll follow you to the ends of the earth as long as you go before me. And a lot of, you know, my family would say, well, what about the kids? You have four kids. And this revelation came to my wife. She's crying out to God one day, and God said, Christy, those kids were mine before they were yours, and I will take care of them if you seek me first. Okay. So we did that. We sold everything. We said, God, we'll follow you. God, take it all, and it was just amazing how God just worked it all out, and we ended up selling the houses and the cars and got rid of 95% of my stuff. I said, God, it's all yours. Do what you want with it. And through this journey, we've been living this life for almost 6 months now. I took God's word at what it said, and God is faithful. I can stand here today and tell you God is faithful. God provides. God, I've never gone a night without feeding my kids or having a roof over my head. God has always provided as I've sought him first. And now, so for the first 30 years of my life, sitting in church, just waiting, 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 never seeing anything. And now for the last 6 months, I've seen a lifetime of God moving. I've seen a lifetime of God showing up. I've seen a lifetime of God setting people free. And I love what I do. I love what I do. It's like me and my wife, we always had this heart and this desire to travel the world. Always had this heart. God put that in there. But for the first 10 years of my marriage, we never went anywhere. I had a high-paying job, guys. I made a lot of money. We went nowhere. And here we are. Now we pursue God. We preach the kingdom. We preach the gospel. And guys, we've been all over the world now. God has fulfilled that dream in our hearts. Okay. I want to say this too. God gave me this revelation a couple weeks ago. even as I've lived this life and walked with God. It's so important to remember that we are saved until the end. We're saved. We're saved again. He who continues to the end shall be saved. Because here I was on the outside, one might look at me and say, yeah, he's in ground four. He sold it all, got rid of the cars. He's following God, right? And yet when I began to teach this, God had me look in my heart, and it was like I was still stuck in ground two. See, in my mind, I thought, okay, I progress from like stairs. Progress from ground one, then I move up to ground two, and then now I've graduated ground two, I'm on to ground three, and then now I'm on to ground four. But God revealed this to me. It's a soil, it's flat ground. So maybe some of you don't struggle with ground three, okay? But maybe you're here in ground two. Guys, we have to continue to check our heart, continue to battle, continue to make sure that we're in ground four, continually be testing our salvation, because this is the only place, this is the only place that we can bear fruit. So if you want to continue, I'll tell you guys, I know persecution's coming. When you begin to preach a full gospel, when you begin to preach the truth, persecution is coming. And God may ask you for things that hold your heart. Maybe for you, it's not your house or your job. Maybe it's something else. I would just encourage you, give it all to him. God has a plan for your life. God knows where he wants you to be. If you just say, yes, I'll go. Jesus, I'll follow you to the ends of the earth. I'll proclaim your gospel to whoever you want me to proclaim it to. And you'll see the power of God in your life as you go. Jesus said he's coming with you. Amen.
For us, it was so weird with when we were in that house, when we lived that life, the normal life, I thought I could do everything. Like, I really thought from my heart that I could live like the world and then give everything to God and seek him. Now I'm actually coming to that understanding that it's not possible. It's not possible to live exactly like the world and then really focus on God and doing that at the same time. I don't know what you need to change, but I will also say that for us, it's not like we feel we are giving up a lot because we have gained so much. It's a life. It's a life. It's a life. And I can say in every area in life now, before, it was like two things. For us in the beginning, it was like we got a house, we got a car, we got things, but we never come to that point that we actually ask God, God, is that what you want for us? Do you want us to have a house? It was actually when I got the house, we should never have got that house. We burned our fingers so much. We ended up to say, we gave it all over to the bank and we got rid of all of it. I know my grand is a father-in-law, he's my spiritual father. He came later to me and said, I told you, I knew it, you should never have had that house. And I said to him, but why didn't you tell me? And he looked at me, had you listened if I did? No, I haven't. Because I wanted it so much. But it actually scared us because now we have it, we are a place where we really don't want things just to want it. We want to know what is God's will. And I can say when we moved to that basement many years ago, I was crying inside. It was like the only door that was open from God. Inside, I was crying. I thought, I cannot live in a basement with three kids. They even did not have their own room. But the basement was the best time for us because we came close as a family, and it was the time where we really saw God and God spoke to us. And now I'm in a place that I know God gave us the best. Not always what we think is the best, but what he thinks is the best for us. And I can say in every area now, I feel the Holy Spirit's leading us, and everything we do, we are led by the Holy Spirit. We have moved a lot. We have lived 15 places the last 20 years. We have moved a lot. And our family, our kids, have not lived like other kids. And in the beginning, like he said, what about the kids? But I can tell you now, I do it for the kids. Because if there is something our kids don't need to see, is people live like the world and go to church on Sunday. What our kids need to see is the real life. Our kids have seen mom and dad cry a lot. I cried so lot, so much. They have seen us cry, they have seen us in pain, but they've also seen God come through every time. And my son, he's now 18. I married him 3 weeks ago. And I'm so proud because he come and say, Daddy, I don't want to have an education. I want to be like you. And they are casting out demons and healing the sick and going to Australia now. Just be led by the Holy Spirit. And God is speaking to them. The Holy Spirit is leading them. And this is what the world, what our kids, what our family need. And for me, I don't owe anything still. I live in faith in many ways. We are going to move again. I say that in faith because we have found a house. We don't have money, but we believe again. But we have seen so many times we did not have money and we did not have anything, but God had provided. I have a car now. A guy came to me a year ago and said, God, he spoke to him that he should give me a car I could drive in. He said, I have like $50,000, go and find a car and I will buy it and you can rent it for cheap for me. And I've always driven an old car, and suddenly a guy come with $50,000, go and find a car, buy it and you can rent it for me, cheap. So I was like, a car, amazing, come on, I'm a man, I like cars. So I like a car. So I was like, what car? So I went in to look at cars. And first I look at a Peugeot, friend's car. And I remember I still there looked at a Peugeot, and there was a beautiful Peugeot, like amazing Peugeot, like a little sports car kind of. And I was looking at that Peugeot and I was like all over the place. And I was like, whoa, I like this car. But then at the same time I felt like, no, God, what do you want me to drive in? Do you want me to have this car? I don't want to drive this car if this car is doing that people don't want God. If people think I do it for the money, I would rather live a simple life, have nothing for the sake to winning people for Christ. So I was looking at the car. I really loved the car, but I was like, no. And I was like, God, I need to find a car today. Shall I buy the Peugeot or what shall I do? And I was praying, I need to find a car, God. What car shall I buy today? And then I felt God spoke to me. And I love the Holy Spirit, how he's leading. I felt the Holy Spirit spoke to me, go to a wedding. What? And there was a wedding in the same city that day. Some people I did not know so good, but I knew them a little. And I just felt so strong, I needed to go to that wedding. I thought, but God, I don't have time to go to a wedding. I had to find a car today. But I just felt it, so I said to my wife, Lena, sorry, I know it's a bad day. I know I need to find a car today. I know we have guests this afternoon, but I just feel I need to go to that wedding. So I take a shower and took nice clothes on me and say, God, what do you want me to do to that wedding? I jump in a car, my old car, boo, 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 and I went to the wedding. And on the way to the wedding, I was saying, God, why do you want me to go to this wedding? I need to find a car today, God. What car? Shall I buy the Peugeot or should I buy another car? What should I do? And God, why do you want me to go to the wedding? Shall I give a word to the wedding couple or what do you want me to do? And I came into the wedding and I feel a little weird to be there, to be honest, because I did not know them so good. And I'm hi. Surprised to see you here. Yeah, also me. And I was there to that wedding, but after the wedding, I sat down, talked with an older man. And I've not met him for years, and we sat down and talked, and we started to talk about the Holy Spirit. He was a Christian. And while I was sitting talking with him, somebody came to him and said, "Hey, are you ready to drive in 10 minutes? And he looked, "Yeah, I'm ready. Just tell me when I'm going to drive and I'm ready to drive." I looked at him, "Drive? Yeah, I'm the chauffeur. I'm going to drive the wedding couple." And we have like tradition in Denmark when people get married, they go out and drive in a nice car out to take pictures and so on. So I looked at him, "Oh, so you have the honor to drive the wedding couple?" "Yeah." "Okay, so you have a nice car if they, since they ask you." And then he looked at me and said, "Yes, I have a nice car. And if you are ever going to buy a new car, young man, you have to buy a Toyota Avensis." And he said it like that, pointing my face, and like, "Actually, I need to buy a car today. But I don't know what car. Can we go out, look at your car?" "Yeah, just join me." So we went out, and just outside the church, there was his car, and it was with flowers and beautiful all over the place. And I stood, looked at the car, and I think, "Whoa, okay, it's Toyota Avensis. Okay, it's a nice car." But I was thinking, "Nice car, but I like the Peugeot better." Then he looked at me, "Young man, this is the best car I ever had. Not like the Peugeot I had before, it always breaks down. Never buy a Peugeot, you had to buy a Toyota." Sorry for you who have a Peugeot. My father-in-law have a Peugeot, good car. And I was suddenly confused and I was thinking, "Well, okay, Holy Spirit, is that really talking, you talking to me?" And then he looked at me the third time. "So young man, this is the car you need to buy. You need to buy a Toyota Avensis." And that day I got a Toyota Avensis. And I know today, every time I sit into that car, I know God is taking care of it no matter what is going to happen. Because it was not my idea to get that car, it was him. That is how we should have it with everything in life. I don't say it's bad to live in a house, but is it God's will? Is it really what God has been saying? Is it God who has been giving it to you? Can you follow me? I don't know what you need to do in your life. We're going to end up now. I want you to look at those foregrounds. You are one of those foregrounds. Is this, it's ready? You are one of those foregrounds. I'm going to just sit and think of this, and then I'm going to play something from our movie with my wife, Lene, who was singing. And while she's singing, just think of it. Think of what ground are you? And think what you need to do in your life to change it so you become ground number four. Maybe it's a small change. Maybe some of you just need to don't work so much. Take one day off in the beginning per week and do other things. Maybe some of you need to get rid of that TV. Maybe some of you need to get rid of that hockey game, play life things you're doing. Hockey, I don't ice hockey, I know it's a big idol here in Canada. I want to end up with this before Lene said. I have a friend from Canada, he shared an amazing story. One day he bought a new car and God spoke to him. "Give the car away." There was a guy who needed a car. I said, I cannot do it. Give the car away. But a few days later, he got a dream. In the dream, he was standing 10 years in the future with the car keys in the hand. And now the car was not a new car anymore. Now it was an old car. And then he was standing with the car keys and he was looking back of all the things he had been left out of because he did not obey God. But the truth is that nobody of you, just before you're going to die, is going to look back at your life and say, "Why didn't I work some more when I had the chance to do it?" Nobody's going to look back on their life and say, why did I not get the bigger TV when I had the chance? But the truth is that many are going to look back at your life and think, why didn't I go the whole way for Jesus? Why did I keep this back? Why did I keep this bad? Why did I keep this back? Why did I think more what other people thought about me than was he was thinking about me? Why did we not pursue our dream? Some of you couples there, well, you had a dream to be missionaries. You have a dream to live 100% for God. It's never too late. But don't sit here in 5 years again or 10 years and think, why didn't I do it? Yeah. God, I pray for everybody in this room. I pray that you will help them. You will speak to them. You know where they are. You know what ground they are right now, God. God, come with your Holy Spirit and speak to them, God. Show them what they need to change in their life to be ground number four. Speak to them. Set them free, God. I ask you that you come with your Holy Spirit right now.